In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. I don't have my mic on, so if you want to come up and hear, if you want to stay where you are, that's fine. Okay. One night during my freshman year in college, I had a bunch of friends in my room, and we were playing rock music at ear-shattering volume, the way we all did. And at one point, my roommate had to find something in the closet, which was as cluttered as it usually is for young men of that age. And he was rooting around in frustration, and he finally poked his head back out and said to us, "Can you guys turn that music down? I can't see." Sometimes we hear something so overwhelmingly that we can't see, and sometimes we see something so overwhelmingly that we can't hear. Sometimes confusion spills over from one sense to another, and we're just plain overwhelmed. That can happen at Christmas time, uniquely in the year, that it often happens at Christmas, because there's just so much going on all around us, so many things we think we have to do, and of course, most of them we really don't. And for some people, this holiday, more than any other, brings their pain and their sense of lostness most agonizingly to the front, precisely because everyone knows we're supposed to be happy. Now, but we are here because it's Christmas morning, two of the most beautiful words in the English language. So why is that? In the midst of all that confusion, what is God's word for us on this day? This day that is supposed to be so beautiful and is so beautiful in the midst of all of this chaos. This world of confusion, this world of too much noise, the world that overwhelms us in whatever way, is the world our Christ comes into. That's why Christ comes into it. Essentially, it's never been any different. There's a video that made the rounds a few years ago on Facebook called An Unexpected Christmas. It was put together by a church in New Zealand. The actors in it are all children in their church school. They act out the story of how Christmas was planned in heaven. At the beginning, God, a blonde boy who looks to be the oldest, about 12, is looking down from these clouds, these big bales of cotton that are around him, through a brass telescope in silence. And finally, he puts down the telescope and he says, "I feel so far from my kids now. It's hard to be friends with people when you don't like what they're doing. I've got to step in." This is why our Christ comes into the world. The confusion, the disconnect, the way that we know things are supposed to be, and the way they actually are. Not the way they're supposed to be in this world. The prophet that we read at Christmas time every year in all three lectionary cycles is Isaiah, as we heard today, because Isaiah understood about this and understood that God would do something about it. Isaiah understood about light appearing in the midst of darkness. Isaiah, more than any other prophet, understood the mystery of human suffering and God's promise that it would not prevail, that it would not go unanswered, that God would lift us out of it. As we heard today from Isaiah, "The Lord has proclaimed to the end of the earth, say to daughter Zion, see, your salvation comes. His reward is with him, and his recompense is before him." Well, there was certainly no apparent evidence at the time Isaiah was writing this that this was what God had in mind. The suffering that he spoke of was not hypothetical. Isaiah lived in the kingdom of Judah, and at the time, Judah, along with all of its neighbors, was under the immediate threat of invasion by Assyria, the most powerful nation-state in the Near Eastern world. And this invasion did in fact happen. People were slaughtered wholesale, children among them. People were deported. Families were destroyed. The society they had was ripped apart. This is the darkness out of which Isaiah is writing. Real historical circumstances, just like ours. Isaiah had seen this coming, as pretty much did everybody else. That's not what makes Isaiah a prophet. What makes him a prophet is his knowledge of God. That the suffering, the crazy-making horror of the Assyrian invasion is not what God wants for us, for his kids. Isn't what God wants us to be doing with each other. What makes Isaiah a prophet is his vision that God is going to do something about this situation. In God's good time, God is going to give us a light. God is going to give us something to see by, to see a way on which we can return to God. And God is going to do this through a person. That's what Isaiah sees, a human being like one of us, one of us. That's what Isaiah saw through the barrier of time, through the confusion, the noise. And he says that this is God's promise to us. God has sworn by his right hand and by his mighty arm. Isaiah knows God's passionate eagerness to redeem God's creation and God's boundless tenacity in bringing humanity to its true home. Isaiah knows that this is who God is. And it's not a coincidence that we hear the same thing in the letter to Titus, written half a millennium later, from Titus. When the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of any works of righteousness that we have done, but according to his mercy. Having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is God's grace that comes before anything we do. This is Jesus Christ, our Savior. And today we celebrate his birth into the world, our world, of noise and confusion. This Christ who lights us out of the darkness that we live in. This Christ who puts us on his back and carries us out of the lostness that is our human condition. Christ who quiets the crazy noise that prevents us from seeing. Christ who calls us back to our true home, to what we know we were created for, to be God's children. A people who, like God, are zealous for good deeds. We want to be that people. On Christmas Day, God gives us the way. Thanks be to God. Amen.